Thank you. The first item of business this afternoon is a statement by Hamza Yusuf on Scotland's ferry services. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions until then. And I call on Hamza Yusuf.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's lifeline ferry services are essential transport links that make a significant contribution to the social, cultural and economic well-being of our nation. This government clearly recognises our responsibility to ensure that these essential services remain at the heart of island and remote communities. This is clearly evidenced by our record levels of investment in the order of £1 billion in vessels, ports and services since 2007. We continue to seek innovative ways to protect and improve the delivery of these ferry services in the future. That's why I am today announcing a review into the legal, policy and financial implications relevant to the future procurement of these services and setting out my reasons for doing so. Now, members may be aware, or indeed have first-hand experience, that since the turn of the century, successive approaches by this and indeed previous administrations have been made to the European Commission covering a range of questions on our obligation to tender ferry services. In 2005, the previous Scottish Executive published its own in-depth report into the consideration of the requirement to tender, which ruled out alternatives to tendering. In 2009, the Commission concluded its own in-depth investigation into Scottish ferry service subsidies. The conclusion was that the service did not meet the Altmark criteria and were therefore covered by state aid requirements. With the exception of the Gourock-Dunoon route, the aid was considered compatible aid, only due to the tendering of the services. The decision also concluded that the Gourock-Dunoon route had to be subject to competitive tendering. In 2012, Transport Minister Keith Brown wrote to Commissioner Almunia encouraging a further review of the requirement to tender ferry services. The Commissioner at that time in 2012 replied, and I quote, "The Commission is, however, convinced that a transparent and non-discriminatory tender for public services is the best way to ensure that the public is afforded the best possible services in terms of both quality and price at the lowest possible cost to the taxpayer. Consequently, the Commission strongly advocates the widest possible use of open and transparent tendering procedures when public authorities and trust companies with a public sector obligation," end quote. The Commission emphasised similar points in their published guidance on the Maritime Cabotage Regulation, dated the 22nd of April 2014, paragraph 5.4.2 states, and I quote, "Launching an open tender procedure is in principle the easiest way to ensure non-discrimination." They also added, "The Commission believes that a direct award fails to respect the principle of non-discrimination and transparency enshrined in Article 4 of the regulation." The Commission, therefore, has, Presiding Officer, consistently advocated the widest possible use of open and transparent tendering procedures when public authorities entrust companies with a public sector obligation. This view has consistently been based on the premise that tendering satisfies the requirement of EU legislation applying to ferry services, including, of course, the Maritime Cabotage Regulation and, importantly, also state aid rules. We do, of course, take very seriously our obligations under European and, indeed, domestic law. We are confident that we currently satisfy all European and domestic requirements for public ferry service contracts. This has been achieved through a number of successful competitive tendering processes over the last 10 years or so, including, of course, most recently, the award of the Clyde and Hebrides contract to Calmac Ferries Limited last year. This award was made in full compliance with the legal requirements and all the advice available to us from the Commission at that time. The tendering of those services has guaranteed their future in a programme of investment and improvements up until 2024. Following a debate in this chamber, Presiding Officer, on the 25th of November 2015, Derek Mackay, the then Minister for Transport and the Islands, wrote jointly with the RMT Trade Union to the European Commission on the 1st of April 2016. The letter followed numerous approaches by this government to seek the Commission's view on the legal requirement to tender the Clyde and Hebrides ferry services. In particular, it sought clarification on the application of the TECL exemption, which was argued could potentially allow the services to be operated by an in-house provider without the need for competitive tendering. The Commission responded on the 22nd of April 2016 formally, stating its view that the TECL exemption should be capable of being applied to the Maritime Cabotage Regulation under strict conditions. This could, if those conditions were met and subject, importantly, to compliance with state aid requirements, allow for the direct award of ferry services contracts to an in-house operator. This response, when considered alongside the Commission's published guidance, suggests that it is appropriate that we now take time to consider further this important issue. I should emphasise that the Commission's response, which I will share in space and put in place in space so that Parliament and members can see for themselves, that response makes clear that in addition to meeting the particular requirements of the TECL exemption, any award to an in-house operator must, of course, comply with stated law, and the Altmark criteria should be considered in that regard. I welcome the Commission's response and have used the time since to consider the complex legal and policy questions it raises. Furthermore, the Commission's response was received during preparations for a live tender exercise for the next Gurrock Dunoon contract. We had already, for example, concluded the pre-qualification assessment and were in the process of informing the participants. It was therefore necessary to give careful consideration to the full legal and policy implications for the tendering process and the current contract before making a public announcement. I have therefore concluded that a policy review should be conducted to identify and consider in detail the legal, policy and financial implications relevant to the procurement of ferry services, including the possible application of the TECL exemption in light of the Commission's letter, the requirement to ensure compliance with stated rules, and all other legal, policy and financial implications relevant to alternative models for procuring ferry services, including examining the organisational structure and the governance of David McBrain Limited and Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited. The review will draw on expertise from across Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government to look objectively at the options and make recommendations to ensure ferry services are affordable, sustainable and provide confidence to ferry users, communities and employees going forward. Our overriding priority is to provide the best service possible within the framework in which we are required to operate, and the review will consider a range of options. Given the number of strict tests which relate to the application of the TECL exemption and stated rules, all of which would need to be satisfied, no assumption should be made on the outcome of the policy review. Nothing can be ruled in or out at this stage. However, whilst not prejudging the outcome, Presiding Officer, should the review conclude that it would be possible to apply the TECL exemption and meet state aid rules, then we would, as a government, be minded to provide ferry services through an in-house operator, taking account, of course, of the communities that they serve. This would, of course, be subject to wider policy and value for money implications, and indeed, importantly and crucially, the views of those communities affected. I am, of course, fully committed to keeping everybody in this Parliament and Chamber informed about the purpose and progress of the review, including, of course, ferry users, local communities, local authorities, ferry operators, and trade unions, as well as members of this Parliament. As a first stage in that engagement today, I will be speaking to a broad range of key stakeholders. I will also be arranging an early meeting with trade unions, in particular the RMT, and Dave Stewart, MSP, who has previously raised these issues with ministers, but also with other MSPs who I know will have a constituency interest, to discuss the purpose and the remit of the policy review. The review will require a specific and urgent focus on the current tendering of the Gurrock Dunoon services, to be closely followed by the implications for the planned tendering of the Northern Isles ferry service. There is less time pressure to reach a definitive future position on the Clyde and Hebrides services. That current contract, of course, has 7 years to go before it will be subject to any potential further tendering requirements. The review will clearly require detailed consideration to be given to a number of very complex legal, policy and financial issues, and this will take time. I am therefore announcing a pause in the current Gurrock Dunoon tendering exercise to allow time for the review to be conducted. This will require an extension to the current Gurrock Dunoon contract in the order of around 9 months, which we have concluded would be justifiable under Regulation 72(1)(e) of the Public Contract Scotland Regulations 2015. Transport Scotland will work closely with the current operator, Argyll Ferries Limited, on arrangements for the intended extension. The review will also consider what, if any, extension period may be justified and necessary for the Northern Isles contract, which is due to end in April 2018. At this point, I would like to assure the people, businesses and communities who rely on our ferry services of the continued delivery of safe, efficient and effective services, and that continuity of service delivery, both now and in the future, remains my top priority during the course of this review. To conclude, Presiding Officer, the final report will set out recommendations for the sustainable delivery of ferry services in the future. It will be made available to Parliament and published on the Transport Scotland website. Ministers will engage closely with key stakeholders when considering the full findings of the review. The final decisions on the best approach to improve the future delivery of ferry services will be based on objective and robust analysis of the evidence provided by the review. Our lifeline ferry services, presiding officer, are essential to the economic and cultural life of our islands and remote communities. I would ask that Parliament joins me in supporting the pause in the tendering for Gourock Dunoon contract and also the policy review and the best approach to delivering our essential and iconic ferry services now and into the future.
Thank you, Minister. We will now have about 20 minutes for questions. If members wish to ask a question, I would encourage them to press their request to speak buttons now, and I call on Liam Kerr to ask the first question.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for an advance copy of his statement today. We welcome the acknowledgement by the Government of the concerns raised in multiple quarters over the recent competitive tendering process for the Clyde and Hebrides contract last year. And I think we can all welcome that the Government has taken action on this and sought clarification from the European Commission. However, there will be genuine concern at commercial ferry operators on seeing this statement today. They will see the government's stated preference for an in-house operator as a direction of travel that may ultimately see an end to competitive tendering for our ferry routes and/or automatic preference to any such operator. So, should the review find that it is possible to apply the TECL exemption and meet state aid rules, would that mean that there will be an end to competitive tendering of ferry services in Scotland? And if not, can he guarantee that any such tendering exercise will not be preloaded in favour of an in-house operator? And can he also today give an assurance that local groups and stakeholders will have a chance to input into this review to ensure genuine feedback into what is affordable, sustainable, and provides confidence to users, communities, and employees?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for the question in the constructive manner in which he asks it? If I can take that last point and give him an absolute assurance that communities will be at the heart of what we're doing in regards to this policy review. Their views are incredibly vital and important to forming our future direction. On this, I'm really keen not to prejudge the outcome of that policy review, but I understand why he asked the question that he does ask. What I would say is that if the TECL exemption can apply, what we've said is if it can apply, if it can comply with state aid rules, but crucially, if communities want it, and I think that's really important, then the government absolutely is minded to make an in-house, make a direct award to an in-house provider. It may well be the case that particular communities, even if all the if all the criteria can be met, if state aid rules can be complied with, it may well be that communities, for a number of reasons that the member actually highlighted in his question, they may not want the direct award, they may wish a competitive tender. Then we should be open-minded to considering what communities want as opposed to necessarily simply what the government is necessarily minded to do. So I don't want to prejudge the outcome of that. I will look forward to hearing from him and his party in the course of that, but I want to give him an absolute assurance that communities will be at the heart of everything we're doing.
Rhoda Grant to be followed by Kate Forbes. Sorry, is it Neil Bibby? Oh, Neil Bibby in that case.
Thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. Firstly, I would like to put on record our thanks to the RMT Trade Union and my colleague David Stewart, MSP, for their hard work and persistence, not only on behalf of the workers in the sector, but also the people who depend on Lifeline Ferry Services. In 2015, Scottish Labour joined the RMT, the Daily Record and others, calling for the government to use the TECL exemption and reject the tendering process for the Clyde and Hebrides contract. That's why Scottish Labour welcomes the announcement today that there will be a review to look at the legal, policy and financial implications on ferry service procurement. Given this review, it is sensible and understandable to extend the current Gourock to Dunoon contract. However, will the Transport Minister provide assurances that there will be the continuity of employment and conditions for the workforce on that particular route and, if necessary, on the Northern Isles route? Can he also provide an assurance that whatever the outcome of the review, that the jobs and conditions will be protected and that the workforce will continue to be subject to TUPE protection? And given the timescales on this matter, can I ask the Transport Minister why it took 4 months for him to publish the response from the European Commission when he said in his statement was received on the 22nd of September.
Minister.
Can I thank the member, and again also thank him for the constructive tone in which he asked the question. Can I also put on record my thanks to the RMT and again the approach that they've taken, and David Stewart as well for his indefatigability on this particular issue. On the questions that the member raises, I can just give him a short answer that yes, the rights of workers, the collective bargaining, the of course continued no compulsory redundancy policy that we have will continue regardless of the policy review. So I can give him that protection. What I would say is that it's very clear from the Commission's response, which again, as I said, is available to members through SPICE, it's very clear that we will have to look at the governance and the structure of both CalMAC and CMAL. That is absolutely going to be part of the policy review. So we'll keep members involved and up to date in that discussion. What I would say also in terms of the fact that we received the response in September and making the announcement today, that's for three very important reasons. First of all, we had to ensure, because this advice was somewhat different to the advice not just received by us, but I should say received by previous executives, including, of course, the Labour-Liberal coalition, because this advice was slightly different, the first thing was and the priority was to ensure that this advice was consistent across all the DGs of the Commission. The second and more fundamentally important reason why I had to give time was, of course, if I had made this public announcement as soon as we'd received the Commission's response, while a live tendering exercise was going on, all sorts of uncertainty would have been thrown up. And I think the member would appreciate, even though he's a strong critic, understandably, of the actions maybe we've taken, he would understand that procurement legislation is extremely complex. And I had to find both the legal route whereby we could halt the current tender, and I think that's important, but also I had to ensure that we had a legally watertight position in order to extend the contract by 9 months. Now, that doesn't mean there won't be a legal challenge. I suspect reasonably that there may well be, but I had to ensure that we had those legal ducks in a row before making any sort of announcement. So I hope that gives him the reassurances that he requires.
Kate Forbes, to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister guarantee that the policy review he announced today will have communities at its heart and ensure the best possible public ferry services to all of our island and remote rural communities who need long-term confidence in their lifeline ferry services?
Minister.
The short answer to that is yes, the communities have to be at the heart of that. As I said, I've travelled around the country in this job in the 9-10 months that I've been in this role, and absolutely communities have differing views on how they think lifeline services should be provided. So yes, they will be at the heart of this policy review.
Donald Cameron, to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Likewise, alongside Liam Carr, I welcome this review and understand the implications of the decision. Representing the Highlands and Islands, I know firsthand how concerned and worried the people of the Cowell Peninsula and Dunoon in particular have been for quite some time about the reliability and frequency of the route. Can the Minister assure me that the 9-month delay to the tender will have negligible effect on the future of this service so that both residents and visitors to Dunoon can soon look forward to a more robust service?
Minister.
Can I just give them the assurances that the continuity of service for me is the absolute top priority? Whether that's in Gourock or Dunoon, the Northern Isles, the Clyde and Hebrides services, the continuity of service absolutely for not just, of course, individuals, but also for businesses, which is so vitally important. So, yes, I can give them that reassurance. I don't want to prejudge the outcome of the review, but, of course, the immediate focus of that review has to be the Gourock Dunoon service, which he rightly mentions.
Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also welcome the review and pay tribute to David Stewart and the RMT for their tenacity on the issue? Can I ask if the trade unions will be involved directly in the review group, and also communities, further to Kate Forbes' question, will they also be involved in that group? They all have a stake, and it's only right that they should have an involvement in the group itself. And can I also ask how long is the review likely to take?
Yes,
questions, I'll try to provide a succinct answer. The policy review will be undertaken by Transport Scotland, but as the key engagers, we will be engaging with the RMT, and straight away, the first meetings that I'll look to have on this will be with both David Stewart and the RMT, which Rhoda Grant is right to say have been leading on this issue. In regards to our second part of the question, yes, again, I can give assurances on that, that the communities will be involved. In the third part of our question, the reason why we've asked for that nine-month extension, which we think is justifiable under 72.1E of the Public Contracts 2015 regulation, is because we think it will take around 9 months for that. Now, if the review kicks up further issues, because state aid can be quite complex, as members will appreciate, then we may have to look again at that timeline. But we're looking to get that review underway as soon as possible within that time scale.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Once again, I want to remind members that my wife works part-time for Calmac and Gourock. In the statement, the Minister spoke about, and also in other comments, he spoke about the current structure and governance of the David McBrain group of companies, which also includes Calmac, whose HQ is in my constituency. Can the Minister provide some further information or in terms of any implications regarding the David McBrain group in my constituency?
Minister.
If I can just give them the reassurances, as I've given in previous answers, that we don't foresee changes, of course, in employees' terms, their conditions, and indeed the no compulsory redundancies policy and collective bargaining policies continue to remain as they are, and that will continue throughout the policy review period. What I will say, though, very frankly, is that part of the policy review, because of the Commission's response, which I would urge the member to have a look at, it makes it very clear that we'll have to examine the governance structure of CalMac and indeed CMAL. Now that, I think, without prejudging again the outcome, we'll be looking at more the management structures as opposed to effects on employees as such. But as I say, I can't prejudge any of that, but I will be meeting with the unions as soon as I possibly can in order to give them the reassurances around employees.
John Finney to be followed by Marie Todd.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for early citing the copy of his statement and welcome the review and indeed support the position regarding Gourock Dunoon. I heard what you said about time frame, Minister, but would you, and whilst acknowledging it's important we get it right, would you recognise the enthusiasm that there is to ensure that the beneficiaries of public money in the Northern Isles ferries are the residents of the Northern Isles rather than the private shareholders of a Circle?
Yes, sir.
I understand the point that the member's making, and all I can say is just to reiterate that the communities will be at the heart of that. I thank him for his welcome to the approach that we're taking. But communities must be at absolutely the heart of that. And having travelled to Orkney and Shetland, you know, it would be fair to say that for them, for the communities that I've spoken to, certainly they want to know about continuity of service. They want, as they've spoken to me, they want to see that reduction in that ferry fares, and we've committed to do that and to examine that, and that won't be affected by this policy review, I should say. So yes, communities should be at the heart very much of that, and as I said, the government is minded where the technical exemption can apply, where state aid rules can be complied with, where the communities want it, an in-house provider, a direct award should be made to an in-house provider.
Marie Todd to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Northern Isles contract is currently due to end in April 2018. I wonder if the Minister can set out what effect this policy review will have on this contract. And can the Minister assure the passengers that the continued provision of the Northern Isles ferry service and continuity in service delivery is a top priority of this government?
Minister.
Yes, I can, and I hope I've been able to do that throughout my statement and answering of these questions, that the continuity of service absolutely has to be my priority and will be my priority and continue to be this government's priority as well. She is right that the contract would end in April 18, and the tendering process for the Northern Isles Ferry Service was due to start in spring. That will not happen because the policy review, of course, will be underway. So already discussions have begun with Serco about a possible extension to that contract and that continuity of service. And of course, we will continue those discussions at a pace.
Tavish Scott to be followed by Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Transport Minister for the statement that he's given to Parliament and the advance copy we have had in. On his last point, does that mean, therefore, that it is nearly sure the current Circle contract for Orkney and Shetland will now extend beyond next summer? Could he also clarify the position with regard to the fares review, because his government have promised substantial reductions on ferry fares to the Northern Isles following the 50% cut to the West Coast? When will we see announcements on that, and will indeed the Orkney and Shetland see those reductions that have been promised? And lastly, Presiding Officer, given the possibility of full Brexit, there would be no EU procurement rules. Will the Transport Minister be minded to ensure his review covers that eventuality as well?
Minister.
Yes, can I thank Tavish Scott again for the constructive nature of the questions. In terms of taking each of his points question by question, in terms of the extension of the contract, I would say it would be highly likely that we'll have to look for an extension to that contract, because no longer can we start the tendering process in spring of this year. We'll have to wait until the policy review is done. So yes, we're already talking to the provider, Serco, about a possible extension, and I'll make sure that he's kept up to date with those conversations. I can also give him reassurances on the work that we're doing to reduce the ferry fares, as the First Minister committed to and as our manifesto committed to. I've always been very clear on this point, that it's not tied to the next contract. In fact, if we can bring ferry fares reductions before that contract, then we would seek to do that. So that position doesn't change. The work of the working group in that respect hasn't changed. And again, I'll keep the member fully informed on the ferry fares reduction. And yes, I can give him an assurance. He is, of course, right that the policy review should take into account the possible implications of Brexit. He understands and knows the Scottish Government's position on all this, so I won't rehearse it. But notwithstanding that, yes, the potential impacts of Brexit will be part of the policy review discussion.
Jamie Green, followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Minister is aware, there are currently three services running out of Gourock. That's three different routes, three different operators, and three different lines of accountability and governance. It's described by one local user group as a complete mess. Now, I note with interest that the Minister doesn't want to preempt the outcome of the review, but in the same sentence does use language like expressing a preference for an in-house operator. So can I ask the Minister if he can confirm today and give some commitment to the long-term security of the Kilcreggan route, because that's very important in this triangle currently funded by SPT, but also, more importantly, reassure this chamber that we don't end up in a scenario where the review outcome gives automatic favour to government-owned operators at the expense of transparency and reliability to local users.
Minister.
Try to give him some assurances. I mean, the Kilcreggan issue is a separate one, and I'll speak to him perhaps offline or write to the member on that. He knows that discussions between Transport Scotland and SPT have been ongoing on this fair funding principle, and in principle we have an agreement to take over that service. So that's a slightly separate issue as to what's in the policy review. In terms of his wider question, I can just give him an assurance on the continuity of service. I can also give him an assurance that communities, and I think I know which community group he's probably talking about, that the wishes of communities will be very much at the heart of what we're doing. In terms of our own government's preference, that is not an inconsistent view at all. I mean, I'm not prejudging the outcome, simply saying that we have made known what our preference is in that regard. And I look forward to hearing from the Conservatives their input into that policy review.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. After years of extensive engagement and correspondence on this issue under this government and previous administrations, what the Minister has announced today suggests that the Commission's view may have changed in the event of a direct award under the TECL exemption. Whilst complex state aid rules will still need to be satisfied, does the Minister agree that the review will encourage many to look forward to the strong possibility that ferry service contracts will be awarded to an in-house operator?
Minister.
Today, that point that I wouldn't want to prejudge the outcome of the review, but the member's correct in saying that, of course, Commission advice, not just to my previous predecessors, Keith Brown, not just in terms of this government, but of course Commission advice received by previous executives and governments has been consistent in that the TECL exemption could not apply. So yes, it would be correct to say that the Commission's view in this respect has seemed to shift. That doesn't mean that there aren't obstacles still in the way, and there's some serious issues that have to be examined. State aid rules, of course, still have to be complied with. Legal, policy and financial questions that have to be answered. And the policy review will look at them in the fullest possible manner.
David Stewart to be followed by Angus MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I warmly welcome this afternoon's statement from the Minister. Nearly 2 years ago, following advice from the RMT, I met the European Commission officials to discuss the TECL exemption. They said, in principle, it was acceptable and consistent with previous European Court of Justice cases. Could the Minister verify the cost to the public purse of tendering the last Clyde Hebridean, Gurwick to Dunoon and Northern Isles ferry services? And in the future, this could be a substantial saving to be reinvested in public services.
Minister.
Can I say what I said at the beginning of this and in some respects pay tribute to the hard work that David Stewart has done on this issue. He's met with me when I first became Transport Minister. On this, so I want to thank him for the advice that he's given in that regard. I'll get him the figures and the facts. If he doesn't mind, I'll write to him. But I know the CHIFS contract, he'll know, came at a cost of £1.1 million in terms of the other contracts he asked about. If he doesn't mind, I'll give him a written response to that. But yes, I can absolutely give him assurance that I'll be looking to engage with him. In fact, we've emailed his office to seek an early meeting with him and with the trade unions to have a discussion on this. And I look forward to his views during that policy review.
Angus MacDonald.
Thank you. Hailing from the Hebrides, I very much welcome the latest advice from the European Commission on the TECL exemption and look forward to the outcome of the policy review. What chance does the Minister see that the policy review will result in a means of procuring ferry services other than by a public tender?
Minister.
Again, if I can just reiterate, I wouldn't want to prejudice the outcome of the review. I've given an indication of where we would be minded to go as a government, but if I can just reiterate that point, that there are some very serious questions that will take time to delve into, from the financial to the legal to the state aid rules and indeed potential implications of Brexit as well. But I think I've made my position and the government's position on this in terms of our preference fairly clear.
Thank you, Minister and members. That concludes